Water has always been the lifeblood of the Isle of Dogs. When London was the world's greatest port, more than 200 ships passed through these docks in a week. These warehouses stored sugar, tobacco, tea, liquor, exotic spices, and many other goods from all over the world. Until the 1960s, trade depended on a large labor force, but mechanized handling techniques were introduced, which needed fewer workers, and much of the business moved downstream and onto Britain's new motorways. In the next 10 years, 150,000 jobs in the docks and associated industries were lost. The unions struggled, but there were splits in the leadership, strikes, and stoppages. By 1981, what was left was unemployment and a dwindling population. Years ago, the island was declared an enterprise zone, and the London Docklands Development Corporation moved in. LDDC is proud of the progress it's made, as Stuart Innes explains.
The corporation was established to address a number of problems, namely in an area of dereliction. Ironically, there was a shortage of land. It was also very difficult if you could get land to get planning permission. There was a need to refurbish the infrastructure. The corporation's powers are tailored to those three essential problems. I think it's clear from everything you see around you and what we know of the development which is coming that there is going to be a dramatic increase in employment in this area. There are jobs which are not the traditional jobs of this area, and we have therefore to ensure that the whole educational process in the area is geared towards the new economy and the new jobs that are coming.
You were in Manchester, I think.
John Fulford is one of the new employers. He bought one of the first new riverside houses and moved his business into the enterprise zone.
Operating here, living and working in this environment, it's exciting, it's new, it's innovative, and there's a touch of the next century about it, and it's a very stimulating environment in which to live and work. There are jobs available, obviously, many jobs have been created, the construction sites, the enormous developments have taken place. Some of those jobs will be available, or have been available to local people. Having said that, there's a number of examples of local enterprise, local people living in the Isle of Dogs who have taken advantage of these new opportunities. There's a gentleman who operates around the corner here cleaning cars, local chap, and he set up a car cleaning business for all these people with their cars in the autos, and I think he's doing very well.
But not everyone accepts that the new service industries make up for the loss of the docks, and some of those who worked the ships believe there was no reason for them to close. George Pye.
I was a little bit amazed at how old it was. You know, they wasn't very modern, though the place had been flattened during the war. So we spent the next 20 years, if you like, building up to the most modern dock in Britain. In fact, at that particular time, we were so modern that people from the continent was coming over to look at our handling techniques. So then to actually have it closed down and lots of lies being told about dereliction was hard to bear. We had full employment on the island. So to actually change all that and then to say that it's for progress. We found a bit of pill to swallow.
So why do the islanders believe they've had so little say in the new developments?
The reason is one of speed. The regeneration of Docklands has to be a dynamic process, and we can't allow too much time to secure a wide spectrum of views and take every detail into account. On the other hand, I think the corporation has been very alive to its community and through its local community networks is aware of the way people feel on different issues and does very clearly take it into account in making its decisions. In terms of housing, I think it's important to remember that the corporation remit did not include directly the provision of rented housing. The corporation is not a housing authority, and much criticism is levied at us, and I think quite unjustifiable criticism, that we have not done enough in the rented sector. Nonetheless, I think our record in terms of housing for local people is impressive.
Despite the obvious signs of wealth, not everyone agrees. Robert Derby is one of them.
But the people who build these houses and who say yes to the development, they don't see the needs of the people around here. They see the needs of their bank balance, and it's all wrong. Like, it does, just does me brains in every time. Obviously, people benefit from it, but none of the people around here, none of the young people. The fact of the matter is there's no chance. You can't buy nothing. You ain't got a chance of getting a flat. And, like, virtually got to be on the street. You know what I mean? You've got to put some young girl in some kind of position where she's got no future, right? And if you're in that kind of position, then you've got no future either. People say, I'd like to get my own flat and I'd like to get a nice job like the yuppies. Do you know what I mean? Like, but you ain't going to get a job like the yuppies because they won't even let you work. They build their offices and their big, big complexes over the docks. And they won't let you work there. They won't have you mixing with them. Well, you see them go past in their nice cars, you know what I mean? You know they're from the outer perimeter of the island, because at the moment the outer perimeter is the posh side of the island, and if you live in the middle, you're nothing. If you can afford to live with them, you'd mix with them. But if you can't, you know the people that you've grown up with.
Many people who remember the old family atmosphere of the island nevertheless accept that times are changing. Ada Price is now a community worker. Buddy Penn runs an urban farm.
It's been here for 11 years, and it's the largest farm in Europe, city farm in Europe. And we have lots of children here, lots of school groups they book up. There's riding schools for the horses. I could say about 8,000 children visit this farm during the course of a year.
We were a close-knit, you know, sort of extended family community with a well-defined area, but now I think we're only at the start of the changes. So we've got some advantages. I mean, we've got a big store that we never had. The railway is really marvellous.
It's a good advantage.
That is, yeah. We wouldn't have had that without the development. We wouldn't have had the railway. Maybe we wouldn't have had the big store either. So they are two plus features.
There is tremendous potential here. The momentum of development is massive, and there's no question about it that this, which is the largest urban development project in Europe, is going to end up in reality as a vast new city, an extension to the City of London, and will play a very important part in the future development of British commerce and industry.
The change that's taking place, of course, is basically not for us. And there's a lot of suppressed anger because they can see it happening and they feel there's not a lot they can do about it. And it's becoming very, very difficult to stop the bitterness and anger overflowing into actual physical sort of violence.
Docklands, I think, in the wider national scene, has set the pace. It's proved a point, and I think it's no accident that the government decided to set up a number of other urban development corporations to use the same model as we have to try to succeed in regenerating other areas of the country. We'll have taken an area from decay to a city of the 21st century.